Mrs. May and Mr. Hammond have let down the Conservative voters. The Conservative voters do not agree with her at all. A small minority. She has let us down. She's led us down the garden path. She got the job by lying about her intentions. She's lied all the way through, as Mr. Rees Mogg has politely described it. She has lied, lied, and lied. And the Conservative voters will not have this.
All right, well, she's not here to defend herself.
Lie is a very harsh word, yes, which I avoid using. But I do think that she and the Chancellor are Remainers and have remained Remainers. And that the Prime Minister gave a press conference Friday, a week ago, where she said this was the Brexit she'd always wanted. And that made me really suspicious, because it wasn't the Brexit she'd promised. And that plays to Trevor's comments.
Let's say there is somehow there is a change in tack. What is it that informs you that you think the other side of the negotiations, the EU, would be willing to give concessions and to give ground that clearly they haven't over the preceding 2.5 years?
Yes, I think that's a very important point. Why would things suddenly be improved now? First of all, they've won on every point so far. So they found that simply by saying no, they've got everything that they could possibly have wanted. We've been very weak and they've been tough. If you turn around and say, OK, look, this deal is off, and we are going to leave on the 29th of March, and you're not getting a penny, and we're going to put 70% tariffs on Irish beef, and we're going to put 200% tariffs on German cars.
They'll respond, of
course. May find... They'll respond.
Whoever won a trade war, Mr. Rees-Mogg?
Donald Trump.
He
seems to win every single one, doesn't he?
Okay. The shares aren't that great now, of course. The Trump bump is over.
I would never judge an economy by a stock market. The stock markets are reflections of value that may have been created in the past, or of movements that are happening separately.
How did he win the trade war then? Because jeans were banned and motorcycles were banned from being sold.
Jean-Claude Juncker went over and immediately agreed to what Trump was suggesting. So if you negotiate toughly, you can sometimes do better. But as we get near to the 29th of March, it may be in everybody's interest to have a simplified deal. You know, we'll pay them a bit of money, but we'll have an implementation period.
You've got time.
Oh, you've always got time. The EU's very good at agreeing things at the last minute.
And when you saw that sort of implacable stance over the weekend from Jean-Claude Juncker and others, this is the deal, this is the deal.
But of course they say
that. Yes, I was going to say, that's just posturing, effectively.
That's posturing to help Theresa May. They've got the deal of the century, so now they're doing their best to back Theresa May. Of course they are. What would you expect?
Trevor, thank you. Ahmed in New Malden. Ahmed, you're on the radio. Good morning.
Good morning, Nick. Good morning, Mr. Rees Mogg.
Good morning, Ahmed.
I respect your views and I like your style, which is excellent.
Thank you.
But may I just say that, you know, you had a very good opportunity to carry out your campaign regarding Brexit, but I think Mrs. May has now achieved the impossible agreement. You know, I think it encompasses and safeguards all the main issues that were of concern to everybody. Now, obviously, the transitional period allows things to be negotiated, and also, you know, the EU, Mr. Barnier and Mr. Juncker and Mr. Tusk, they have all said we will remain allies and in...
I've got to move you to your question, my friend Ahmed. What is your... I'm so sorry. Yes, thank you, sir.
Shouldn't you now allow Mrs. May to get on with this, and she should have the support of all our MPs and everybody else?
Ahmed, you make a very sensible point that in an implementation period, transition period, there may be things that people don't like. And I was willing to accept that with an end date of December 2020. It was a compromise, but a sensible one that helped ease the changes that were going to be made. What is different is the backstop, because the backstop would keep us tied to the EU as a rule taker in perpetuity. There's no exit. And the best argument that the government can come up with is that the EU doesn't really like the backstop anyway. If the EU doesn't like the backstop, why was it so insistent about the backstop? Why did it write it into the text and demand that it was there? So I'm afraid that line from the government I simply don't believe. The backstop has no end date, and that means we are a rule taker from the EU and we're paying for the privilege. That's not the Brexit people voted for.
Thanks for that, Ahmed. Marianne in Belfast. I'm concerned that this could affect me and my children, my family, as we live here in Northern Ireland. Can Jacob Rees-Mogg spell out exactly the fears? And are we, as some people say, going to be taking our rules from EU but staying in the UK? What would you say to Marianne?
I think Marianne is right to be concerned. The position for Northern Ireland is deeply troubling because its law will be more influenced by Dublin than by Westminster.
Only during the transition is what the Prime Minister would say.
No, during the backstop.
Yes, during the backstop.
But the backstop doesn't have an end date. So you say, we've discussed
it. But they can't legally, neither party can legally stay in it, can they? They have to show best endeavours to find a way out of it and whatever it may be.
On what basis? What's the legal opinion that says that?
But that's what I understood.
That's what the government's been saying.
Yes, that's what the government
says. But the government said a lot of things have turned out not to be true. If you look at Article 50, it says the framework for the future relationship. If this is agreed as the framework for the future relationship, that's covered by Article 50 and has legal standing, and they've put in the supremacy of the European Court of Justice, which would have been the risk to it. If that weren't in, then there would be the chance of it being overruled. But it's got ECJ approval, it's got a customs union in perpetuity, it's got no exit mechanism unilaterally for the UK. So we're more tightly bound than under the Lisbon Treaty in Article 50 to the rules coming from the EU in certain areas. And I think this is very troubling for Northern Ireland because as long as the backstop is there, Northern Ireland's regulations, I think there are 291 listed regulations that would be EU law applying in Northern Ireland over which the Northern Irish would have no say. That's really worrying.
And just last before I come to the next caller, which is going to be Michael, do you think, and I'm not for one moment putting forward the idea of a second referendum, because I think actually that could be quite dangerously divisive, so I'm not supporting that, but do you think the great British public, seeing what they see themselves now, knowing what they know, do you think they'd still have voted Brexit?
They'd have voted Brexit, but they might not have wanted Theresa May to be their leader to deliver Brexit. The country is much braver than the politicians. Politicians are basically, Theresa May and the current government's in the business of managing decline. It's got no confidence in the ability of Great Britain, United Kingdom, to do better. And that's why it's got this very bad deal. It's about tying ourselves to the apron strings of Europe, because we think if we're not tied into that, we can't succeed on our own. I reject this analysis. I think we do much better on our own. And that's what people voted for. And they voted for it in their droves, in spite of being told by the OECD, the IMF, the Bank of England, the Treasury, that we were all doomed if we dared to disobey our betters. And that shows the wonderful spirit of the British people, their optimism about their own future. And it's a deep sadness that a Conservative government is so craven.
Michael in Edinburgh. Michael, you're through to Jacob Rees-Mogg. Go ahead, sir. Good morning.
Yeah, good morning. Good morning, Jacob.
Good morning, Michael.
The issue that I want to mention is to do with the Rock of Gibraltar. But,
yes.
You know, I just want to say, Theresa May has, I know you don't like the expression lied, but she's given us so many mistruths that I'm very, very angry. I think we're being led up the garden path so severely that we'll never get over it. But, you know, if
come to Gibraltar if you would, because we're heading into our last couple of minutes, Michael, and
I want you to be sure
to get your question across, sir.
Yeah, well, she's telling us that Gibraltar, the sovereignty of Gibraltar is not in question here, and that, you know, everything will be nice and smooth at the end. But, you know, are we to believe that? She's told us that we're not going to be in the customs union. She's told us that we're, you know, in a fine position in that respect. But she has told us mistruths. And is she telling us mistruths over Gibraltar? You know, is she going to hand it to them on a platter?
Well, I don't know whether she'd do that, but Jacob Rees-Mogg?
I would like to say that my default position is to trust statements made by the Prime Minister and leader of the Conservative Party, but the evidence is that I can't say that, because we were told we'd be out of the customs union, we wouldn't divide up the United Kingdom, and we'd be out of the jurisdiction of the European Court of Justice. None of these turn out to be true. So when, Michael, you say to me, can I be certain about Gibraltar, when the Spanish European minister is saying it's the best deal since 1713, which is, I think, around the time of the Treaty of Utrecht, the time of the Treaty of Utrecht, I think the Spanish may be telling us something that we should listen to.
You're worried about Gibraltar?
Well, Mr. Picarda isn't, as the Chief Minister of Gibraltar.
Yes.
And I think it's always dangerous to be more Catholic than the Pope. So I will listen to Mr. Picarda's future statements with
but there's
care.
There's a concern.
There's a concern because Mr. Picarda may be relying on what the Prime Minister is saying.
Just last minute, a couple of questions from me, if that's all right, Mr. Rees-Mogg. I know you, like I, in the mornings, always turn to the Times leader articles to get an idea of what's going on. And to summarise their lead article, is that any other idea of a supposed plan B is a fantasy or peddled by fantasists. This is the only deal on offer. They don't go to say it's a good deal, but this is the only deal on offer, therefore we should probably move towards it.
Jacob, well, this morning I read The Sun first, and I read Trevor Kavanagh's brilliant piece, which I would encourage all your leaders to look at.
Listeners.
But, your listeners, sorry. Your readers,
I have many readers
in the Sunday Express as well. Yeah. I think Trevor hit the nail on the head in his piece about the failures of this deal and indeed of Theresa May. As far as the times go, well, then we leave without an agreement, and that's not something to be frightened of. We can get through that remarkably well, and then we get all the benefits of Brexit, which we don't talk enough about. This really exciting opportunity to make our economy better, make the standard of living for people better, reduce the cost of food, clothing and footwear, helping the least well-off in our society, controlling immigration, helping wages, again, for the least well-off in our society. Really exciting opportunities from leaving, which we will get if we go on the 29th of March cleanly.
All right, and lastly then, to borrow another great campaigner for The Sun, if I were to turn you into Mystic Mogg, as opposed to Mystic Meg from The Sun, in 2 weeks' time we're due to meet again, God willing. Where will the country, where will the Prime Minister find herself when we meet again in 2 weeks?
We will be waiting with bated breath for the meaningful vote, which I hope will fail.
Mm. Do you think she's going to make any ground?
I don't think... Well, opinion polling is that the country recognises this deal for the dud that it is.
Thanks for your time.
Thank you, as always.
Time for it. Jacob Rees-Mogg, Conservative MP, of course, chairs the ERG. Joining us here on LBC, where the time is 9:31.